fire the front! Quick! March!
I want every soldier to know that I have complete confidence in the successful outcome of the operations that we are now about to begin. With stout hearts and with enthusiasm for the contest, let us go forward to victory.
Normandy veterans.
Honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome
to Beacon Key. Welcome to Beacon Key on today, the 6th of June. We've done this on purpose. We've put together the rain for you this morning. The sound is down.
My voice will have to work on its own.
Because the greatest show that we've ever had was on the 6th of June, 68 years ago. 68 years, let's go back just for that day. 12 o'clock at night, the British and Allied forces landed in France. Just to give them mayhem, just to keep the Germans away from the beaches. The beaches, the names will be marked forever in history. Utah, Omaha, Gold, Juno, Sword, names that are etched in time. The preparation for this was absolutely incredible. It took years from Dunkirk to get it all together. And everything on this particular day hinged on the weather. And look at the weather today. We've asked for this because we wanted you to have a feel of what it was like to have to go into battle, not in sunshine, but in rain. If you remember right, the Normandy landings were postponed for 24 hours. There was a man called Commander Stagg. He's a meteorologist, an RAF man, and he came to Eisenhower and he said, look, the weather's not good. We'll have to postpone it. And then a little ship from the Royal Navy, just off the south of Iceland, got a glimpse of a weather pattern that was about to change, and the pressure started to rise. And he said, we should take this opportunity if possible. Eisenhower looked at Montgomery and he said, what do you think? Well, you know Montgomery. And he said, I think we should go, sir. And that's what happened. At 6:30 in the morning, the greatest armada was on those beaches, and in they went. The weather, it was acceptable. And those beaches had been chosen by you, your grandparents, with photographs that your holiday had. And we looked at the beaches, and they said, yeah, that's good. That's good. And that's how they were born. And it turned out to be the longest day in the life and the history of a battle and an armada that sank. If we come back into England, you must remember that this had been planning for about 4 years and everything was coming together. But the ladies will tell you that we had a time where we had to have coupons for everything. The girls, if they wanted to go out and look nice, they couldn't go into Hooper's. They had to have coupons, so they stained their legs a little bit to make them brown. Not a little suntan unit. And then they would take a line down their leg and make it that they look like nylons. And then in January 1944, the world changed in this place because we were suddenly introduced by Americans. Now, if you've never seen an American, there's one here today. Have a look at him. He's got a uniform that seems quite different. And it wasn't long before they got something together and they said, they're overpaid, you know. And they seem somewhat oversexed, and they're over here. Can you imagine coming to
the time
full of women? But the English ladies knew their place, and they gave them quite a challenging time. That was, except one woman that I knew, my auntie. And I remember one night, the family got together, they needed to talk to her. And they said to me, Marsh, go on, off to bed. What do you mean, it's delight? Off to bed, and off I went. I sat on the stairs and I listened, and there it all came out. She said, the family said, the people are talking about you. You're the only girl that knows all the men in the American Sixth Fleet by name. So you can imagine what it was about. But you know, when the Americans came here, they went down to Slaughton and they replaced the people that lived there. The people were moved away from Slaughton, but then thousands of these Americans arrived. And one of the greatest disasters in the Second World War took place on the 27th to 28th of April 1944. We had a practice run, and it came in, and the ships were there. There were 30,000 men in a training exercise, but it had got to be the very best there was for this particular time on the water. We lost our communications. Our timing went out by half an hour. The men were landing on the beach and they were being bombarded by our own ships. And then the marauders, the predators of the Germans, sneaked from Cherbourg and came across in their E-boats. They're capable of 50 miles an hour. Torpedoes, guns, the lot. And they used to go out like large whites. And all they wanted to do was to look and find somebody somewhere to really just take apart. More men were lost that night than on the raid itself. The count has gone up to 749. But I watched the program the other night and they think it's going to be over 1,000 when it finishes the count. But that is Slaughton in our own area. We went further as we came up to the Dart. There were 400 to 500 big ships in the Dart side. People were really pulling together. I've got a very good friend, Betty Walton Buddha. She was there as a wren, and she said to me, Marshall, they were so young, these people. They were 17, or some of them. Some of them were 18. Away from home. In Torbay, they really looked after them. The people took them into their hearts. So
some of the officers, some of the men were billeted with the families. Absolutely incredible. And they wanted them more than anything else to feel happy during their stay while they were here. And there was a tune going around at the time. You had your breakfast in bed before, but you won't get it here anymore. And they turned that music around because the only thing that they wanted to do was to give these boys a place in this area. And of course, on the 4th and then the 5th of June, they marched down here. And there we are with the most famous slipways here. Most people read this sign and get the story. But when they look down there, that is where all the men went. Our own boys were at Plymouth and Portsmouth. But it was a marvellous achievement. Gentlemen and ladies this morning, I am so proud, and I know you are, because we have in front of us men that were there. Men that I look at now later on in life, and their backs are straight, their shoes are clean, they have the finest, well, they have the finest comradeship that you could ever have in your life. The man at the side of them would lay down his life for you, and you would lay down your life for him. There are young people here today, young people that I know have got that fighting spirit and will go into the service. We envy you and we think of you. And wherever you are, we will never forget. And we thank you this morning for our freedom.
And we continue to represent the military aid for the civil power, i.e. the mayor, Paul Mortimer. If the natives are getting restless, I'm here to help police. You're watching my back, aren't you? And I'm actually involved as the maritime support commander at Port of Weymouth for the forthcoming Sailing Olympics. And those of you on parade on the 7th of June on the Ho at Plymouth, I'll be there. I'm also running the National Armed Forces Day. We talked on 68 years ago. The reason why I'm actually here when I could be elsewhere is because of loyalty to a very special community and around very special people. Royal Navy today is hugely busy, but out there, not seen, far away, very operational, very busy. 22,000 to 7,000 Royal Marines, that's us, hugely committed. This sort of parade, very special service, enables us to remember, yes, goodness, bricks and paint and torty are next to the sea. Only out there brings everything in there, 95% of our trade into Tesco or whatever. 6th of June, 44 from Beacon Key, the Royal Navy, with a little help from the slightly larger American forces, went on to Gold, Omaha, Juno, Beach, Sword. This time, 30 years ago, 21st of May, the Royal Navy took a task group 8,000 miles against the foe that's numerically 3-1 against us. That's not correct in amphibious doctrine, which means you're barking to do it, especially winter coming on, especially for the politicians of that day. Any names to follow? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you very much for allowing it to happen. Please, and this is an order, not a request, not we're going to have another Jubilee for 10 years' time. Well, I want to do another 20 and 30 years, please. That is another order, not a request. Talking about the Falklands, dramatis personae, to the fore, where were you, sir? Which one? 4-5 Commander. Falcon Amphibious Landing Force, where the Royal Marines and Parachute Regiment, took 5 years to join them. Not there to talk to Martin. Barry, then Signals Colour Sergeant for 4-2 Commando. Now running Wyburn Barracks, unique for his party in Exeter, seeing George Arnold. He runs extremely good barracks and a good man and good man on time. I had a big part then, and I only probably went there with a few prayers. Took me on to England, it's always here, always a spectacle, local. When they had 165 padres, now down to 130, such circumstances, like all of us. It's amazing, time of war, religion, and it's in peace too, ever lurking there, which provides that catalyst, like number 36 branch, provides that catalyst and inspiration. When there was no rain, best of luck to you all, and thank you.
Standard bearers, carry standards.
Let us remember with thanksgiving and honor all those who served the army. In the cause of freedom and peace, they shall burn us all as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn the going down of the sun, and in the morning we will.
Yeah. International relationships, that they may find the true way to reconcile people of different race, color, and creed. Eternal God, the Father of men, we commit to thee the needs of the whole world. Where there is hatred, give love. Where there is injury, grant pardon. Where there is distress, restore peace. Where there is sorrow, renew hope. Where there is darkness, let there be light. Through Jesus Christ, Amen. Pledge ourselves anew to the service of God and our fellow men. Let us pray that we may work together for the advancement of peace and the welfare of the nation. O Almighty God, grant we beseech thee that we who here do honour to the memory of those who have died in the service of their may be so inspired by the spirit of their heroism and sacrifice, that forgetting all selfish and unworthy motives, we may live only to thy glory in the service of mankind through Jesus Christ. Veterans of the Normandy campaign, grant we beseech you your blessing and strength to carry on our work, to aid and bring progress to all mourners.